I'd like to introduce our main speaker tonight, who is Professor Sanjay Sharma. Sanjay is the Professor of Inherited Cardiac Diseases and Sports Cardiologist at St. George's, and his main research interests are how the heart and the blood system, the cardiovascular system, adapt to exercise, and in particular, in relation to this issue of sudden cardiac death in sport. In that subject, he is a world leader. And if I just tell you that he was the lead cardiologist at the London Olympics 2012, covering all of those major endurance sports, you will realize that he is particularly renowned internationally. He's also the cardiologist for the English Institute of Sport, the British Rugby League, and the British Lawn Tennis Association. We have a couple of other guests tonight, which I'm going to leave to Sanjay to introduce, but I'm going to hand over now to Sanjay to start off our evening. Thank you very much, Sanjay.
Thank you very much, Julian. My name is Sanjay Sharma. It's a great pleasure, really, to welcome you to talk about this issue that's become very pertinent in the last 2 years, especially with what went on in football in 2012, and of course the London 2012 Olympics. But before I start on the topic of sudden cardiac death, I'd like to emphasize upon you that exercise is very good for all of us, and as physicians, certainly any physician in the room, as ambassadors of our patients, we should be promoting exercise to everybody. It's well established that exercise curbs obesity, which is one of the government's major goals at present. It improves blood pressure and lipid profile. It increases insulin sensitivity and therefore reduces the risk of diabetes. And by controlling all of these risk factors for coronary artery disease, people who exercise regularly reduce their chances of having a heart attack by 50% in their 50s and 60s. It's also well established that people who exercise moderately, by that I mean walk at a pace of a 15-minute mile five times a week for 30 minutes, live about 7 years longer than those people who don't exercise at all. Apart from these cardiovascular benefits, we know that exercise improves or reduces the risk of certain cancers, such as carcinoma of the prostate and the colon. It's supposed to be an antidepressant for some people, such as myself, and there is emerging evidence that it may retard the risk of dementia. So I don't think there's anybody in this room that would argue that people who exercise regularly, particularly elite athletes, do represent the healthiest segment of our society. These young individuals thrill us with their extraordinary physical ability, and they're a source of inspiration and aspiration to our youth. But having seen all of this and just seeing what an athlete is capable of, it is also true that a young and apparently healthy individual may die suddenly during competition or during intense exercise. Such deaths are highly publicized by the media that often relate to the age of the individual, the circumstantial paradox, and the number of life years lost. I'd like to take you back 20 years ago. A man that's just scored a basket here was one of the best collegiate basketball players at the time. Looks absolutely fine at the moment. And these are slightly disturbing scenes, but what you're seeing is a man who's not receiving any blood to his brain because his heart's gone into an abnormal rhythm. He's quite strong. So the rhythm seems to have sorted itself out, and he's back up on his knees now. And now going back down again. And you can see him thrashing around there due to lack of blood going to the head. Now, I can tell you that there was a defibrillator on that basketball court, and it was never used because the physicians and the people looking after this individual could not believe that a young person was capable of harboring a cardiac condition that could potentially kill that person. The good news is that sudden death in young athletes is rare. The incidence is around 1 in 50,000. The mean age of death in athletes, these are young athletes, is 23 years old. I'm going to focus mainly on young athletes, that is those aged under 35. It's important to emphasize to you that 40% of deaths in athletes occur in those of high school age, sixth formers and fifth formers. Deaths are more common in males than females. There's a 9-to-1 male predisposition. And if we look at recreational athletes, that's 20-to-1. So men seem to be much more vulnerable to sudden death than females. And this is not just explained by increased participation rates. 90% of deaths occur during or immediately after exertion. There are a plethora of conditions that cause sudden death, but the vast majority are hereditary, or that is, they run in families, or congenital, that is, that someone is born with a defect that may cause a death. And these abnormalities can affect the heart muscle, the blood supply of the heart, the valves of the heart, and the electricity of the heart. And people with these problems that exercise are 3 times more likely to die than people who've got the same abnormalities that don't exercise, suggesting that in people with these substrates, exercise is actually a trigger for sudden cardiac death. So if you imagine that we've got a heart muscle fault here, it's not surprising if we look at the triggers and the metabolic effects of exercise, such as dehydration, adrenergic surges, electrolyte imbalance, and acid-base disturbance. If all this sets in and someone's already got a heart problem, it's possible that the heart may go into a dangerous rhythm, culminating in a sudden death. The commonest cause of sudden death is a condition called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which was responsible for causing the death of Mark Vivian Foe whilst he was at Manchester City. He died during a friendly game in the Federation's Cup. This is a genetic condition that runs in families that is characterized by abnormal thickening of the heart muscle and a predisposition to fatal rhythm disturbances, particularly in young people who exercise regularly. And these people, usually, because of the very thick heart and the scar tissue within the heart, can't usually do a lot of exercise because they can't augment their stroke volume. But having said that, this condition is very heterogeneous. By that I mean it can take several forms. And there are some people who have this condition that are capable of doing very well in sport, particularly start-stop sport, such as football, basketball, and baseball. They're not very good at long-distance cycling, marathon running, because they cannot augment stroke volume for long enough periods, so they don't excel in those sports. But you can play Premier League football with this condition. Some people can. So, as I said, some people die suddenly, yet some people can compete for a long time and may die. The deaths are rather unpredictable. And then there's this other condition called arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, which is a mouthful, which is effectively a genetic condition that's characterized by the right ventricle, that's the right pumping chamber, being replaced by fat and scar tissue. And this is the commonest cause of sudden death in young Italian athletes. It's a condition that's quite difficult to diagnose. And the fault here is with the glue that keeps the heart muscles together. The glue proteins that keep the heart muscles together are abnormal. So you can imagine if an athlete is pushing themselves, running very, very hard, and they've got defective glue or cement, then you can imagine that this glue comes apart and may put the patient into a nasty rhythm disturbance, which may harbour as a blackout without warning, or a rapid attack of palpitations associated with breathlessness, or all too often, a sudden cardiac death. There is data from Mary Shepherd, who's our newly appointed professor of cardiac pathology, that certainly in our population, about 23% of athletes that die suddenly, when we do an autopsy on them, we find nothing at all. And you can imagine the media have a ball when they're looking for a cause of death and the pathologist says nothing found. And you get all sorts of things that he must have abused drugs. It may have been erythropoietin, it may have been amphetamines. But it's also true to say that a lot of deaths that do occur in athletes occur due to electrical faults, which are invisible and will not be identified by a pathologist. So we get death due to heart muscle faults and due to electrical faults. Can we pick these young people up before they die? Well, you can see there are various manifestations, including chest pain, breathlessness that's disproportionate to the amount of exercise being performed, palpitation, dizziness whilst exercising, blackouts, or even a transient epileptic fit. You saw that basketball player, when he wasn't getting enough blood to his brain went into overdrive and he was fitting. Sadly, 80% of people that die have no symptoms at all, and sudden death is the first presentation. So if we're not going to pick them up through symptoms, is there anything else we can ask a young person that may raise suspicion that there could be something wrong with that individual? I explained early that most conditions that cause death in young sportsmen are genetic. So when we inquire, when we talk to young people, we ask them, is there a family history of heart disease? Now, if they turn around and said, Granny died at the age of 95 from a heart attack, that's not really what I'm after. I'm after, did anyone in your family die below the age of 40 from a heart problem? Or has anyone been diagnosed with a heart problem below the age of 40? Has anyone died suddenly below the age of 40? Has anyone in the family got epilepsy, bearing in mind that cardiac faults may manifest as epilepsy? Has there been an unexplained drowning? You get a good swimmer who goes into the water and never comes back up. Long QT deaths manifest like that. And sometimes people say, he was such a great driver, God knows what happens, he just veered off and smashed into something and we found nothing at post-mortem on the heart. That could also be an electrical fault that led to the patient crashing their car. Can we diagnose these conditions? The answer is yes, we can. We can diagnose these conditions with tools that are available in most cardiac hospitals. So talking to them, listening to their hearts, doing ECGs, echoes, 24-hour tapes, stress tests. And of course, some people need more sophisticated tests to make the diagnosis. But most conditions can be diagnosed with relatively simple investigations. And if we do diagnose them, is there anything we can do at all? Or are we just labeling them with a condition that's going to screw up their psyche and cost them their insurances and travel insurances and all the rest? Well, of course we can. Generally, we ask people with these serious conditions to abstain from moderate to intensive exercise. There are various treatments, I'm not going to go into all of those, varying from pills to ablation therapies where we freeze off electrical pathways to surgery that may prevent sudden death with loads of these conditions. So we know what causes death, we know how we can pick it up, and we know what we can do about it. So should we be screening all our athletes to identify those that may die? Well, screening is very controversial. There are many antagonists, A, because it's not state-sponsored and not available on the National Health Service, and deaths relating to screening are usually galvanised by the sudden death. I am the cardiologist for the charity Cardiac Risk in the Young. As you can see, that's plastered all the way down here. They're great sponsors of St. George's Hospital, and Steve Cox will speak about them. He's their deputy chief executive. But we have been completely inundated since that catastrophic event. But it's sad that it took something like that for people to start worrying about their hearts. So are these arguments against screening real? Well, it's true to say that sudden death is rare, 1 in 50,000. Maybe we should be spending money on other things that are more common, such as heart failure and heart attacks, because they cause 120,000 deaths a year in the UK. These are rare conditions, and the pathology is diverse, so no single screening test will pick every single patient up. And if you really wanted to do proper screening, then the screening is very elaborate and cost may be prohibitive. There is also the risk that people who exercise a lot, their hearts have to grow to accommodate all this blood and to pump 30 litres of blood around the body per minute. And these adaptations may lead to false changes on the ECG and echo that may be erroneously diagnosed as heart faults. But you saw from that video that these are visible events. They do cost young people numerous years of life. If someone with heart failure dies at the age of 85, they've probably lost 2 years of life. But when an 18-year-old guy dies playing football, they've lost 60 or 70 years of life. There is an association between exercise and sudden death, there's no doubt about it. And there are acceptable interventions. Indeed, if we look at the scientific community, the Americans and the Europeans feel that we should be doing something to detect athletes with silent cardiac conditions. The debate arises in what we do exactly. The Americans feel that we should be picking these people up with a health questionnaire and an examination. The health questionnaire should relate specifically to symptoms of cardiac disease and a family history of cardiac disease. And on examination, you should be looking for heart murmurs or high blood pressure that may identify young people. I told you earlier that 80% of people that die suddenly do so with no symptoms at all. And although as cardiologists we're very proud to wear our stethoscopes around our necks, the sort of conditions that cause sudden death rarely cause signs on physical examination. So this type of protocol will miss the vast majority. The Europeans, on the other hand, the Italians specifically, have a screening program that's been in practice for 30 years, where all young people that exercise or compete at high level have a health questionnaire and an examination, just like the American model, but they also have a 12-lead ECG, which is a simple electrical tracing of the heart. Those with abnormal findings are investigated further, and if they're diagnosed, they're managed according to established protocols. If they're not diagnosed with anything, they're eligible to continue to compete, and then they're tested again every year. And these ECGs, these are the ECGs, pick up very serious electrical faults of the heart. No one will argue with that. I told you earlier that the commonest cause of death in sportsmen are heart muscle faults, and they normally need cardiac ultrasounds. But can the ECG raise awareness of these people? Well, 95% or more people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy have an abnormal ECG. And around 80% of people with high-risk arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy also have an abnormal ECG. So the abnormal ECG in an athlete may be the first time that you actually find out that someone may be harboring a cardiomyopathy that was unsuspected. And I'm sure you'll hear a little bit more about that from an athlete very shortly. So this is a study in Italian athletes, 33,700, where they picked up 22 cases of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Only 23% were picked up on the basis of a health questionnaire and an examination. The remaining 73% required an ECG. So based on this, if we want to detect people, more people, we should be doing more than just a health questionnaire, and we should be doing a minimum of a 12-lead ECG. Does screening actually save lives? Okay, it detects people, but does it save lives? That's the million-dollar question. And there's only one country that can answer this, because there's only one country that has mandated screening with ECG for over 30 years. The only other country that does this today is Israel. So it's only Israel and Italy that mandate ECG screening. In this country, only the top athletes have ECG screening. The Sunday League people, the amateurs, do not get any form of screening at all. So here are death rates in non-athletes, the yellow line, over 25 years, and in athletes, the red line. And you will see that when screening first started, death rates in athletes were four times greater than that in non-athletes. And as ECG screening has progressed, the death rates in non-athletes has remained static. These are people that aren't screened. But the death rates in athletes have gone down and are now below those of non-athletes. In fact, there's a 90% reduction in sudden death over 25 years since the Italians adopted this model. So good is the data that the European Society of Cardiology, the International Olympic Committee, and the Football Association all endorse screening. And whether we like it or not, the Football Association, Rugby Union, Rugby League, English Cricket, Lawn Tennis Association, and all these American professional footballing organizations all perform ECG screening in athletes. So as cardiologists in the audience, whether you like it or not, you better get used to assessing athletes with abnormal ECGs, because there'll be more and more coming your way. Of course, there are concerns about all of this. Sudden death is rare. What about false positives? What if we erroneously disqualify an athlete because we find something on the ECG that actually doesn't mean anything? Does ECG screening miss things? What about cost? We've got to worry about cost in this situation. You can never get away from cost. And what about other issues? And I'd like to address these one by one. Sudden death in sport is rare. The risk is 1 in 50,000. But if we did screening, if we did ECGs on thousands and thousands of people, we would find that one in 300 young people, whether you look at UK, US, Australia, Italy, one in 300 young people harbours a condition that could potentially kill them. So if we're going to debate about whether we should screen or not, this is the data we should be using. Who are we going to pick up? At the end of the day, the aim is to pick people up before they die. One in 300. What about the risk of false positives? It's true that people who exercise regularly have to increase heart size to be able to pump 30 litres of blood around the body per minute. And as a result, they get electrical changes on the ECG. They get structural changes. And they have functional changes, all of which promote augmentation of stroke volume. And so we get physiological changes on the ECG and the echo. Sadly, a small number of these athletes also exhibit changes that overlap with mild manifestations of cardiac diseases, such as the cardiomyopathies, resulting in the potential of false positive tests. Now, the false positive rate at the moment is around 10%, which most of you would say is pretty unacceptable. So if you went into a school like Eton and screened everyone, and one in 10 people had to be coming back for more tests, you may say, well, hold on a minute, I don't think this is a very good idea. But here you can see two people of the same age. One's a librarian, and the other one is a Tour de France athlete. What you can all see, even if you didn't go to Specsavers, is that this guy's got a much bigger heart than that. Some of you will also appreciate that this heart is contracting dynamically. This heart's hardly doing anything. And an inexperienced cardiologist who doesn't look after sportsmen will look at that and says, oh my God, it's a horrible heart muscle condition, and maybe this person shouldn't exercise anymore, because that's what it does look like. And 20% of Tour de France athletes have a heart that looks a bit like this. And sometimes differentiating between physiology and pathology is a big deal, and I'm often faced with that when I'm dealing with Premier League football players, when you've got the manager and their agents knocking on your door as soon as you start saying hello to the patient. And this issue is really relevant in black people. Black athletes, who make up 20% of the GB Olympian squad and 20% of our Premier League, have more bizarre ECG changes. They have a thicker heart muscle than white athletes, which overlaps with a condition called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And if we believe the data from the States, a black athlete is 8 times more likely to die during sport than a white athlete. And this is a black athlete's ECG. The non-medics here, to you this means nothing, but to the medics, if this guy came in clutching his chest today, he would be diagnosed as potentially having a heart attack, and he would be rushed up to our cath lab to have an angiogram, because that's what their ECGs look like. And whereas only 3% of our white athletes have a slightly thickened heart muscle that may overlap with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, almost 1 in 5 black athletes, male athletes, have thickened heart muscles that sort of cause a diagnostic dilemma. And we had our own issues in 2012. You imagine my job and my team's job, I shouldn't take the credit myself, was, along with CRY, to screen every single GB potential member. And we had our own issues when we were seeing ECGs like this. And the question was, should this man compete or not? This is 2 months before the Olympics. And this will become very relevant in a minute when you see who it is. But we had our own issues when we were dealing with the Olympians. So how did we do it? And this is where CRY comes in. I need to say a few words about CRY. I've been working with CRY since I was a junior doctor, and they've been very, very supportive to me, and I don't think I would be where I am without them. But they have been very pro-screening, and they have been responsible for screening all athletes for the English Institute of Sport, Rugby League, Rugby Union, Lawn Tennis Association, and also were responsible for all the Olympian screening. And they were donated this van by Philips a long time ago, which moved up and down the country screening athletes before the Olympics. And this is what was going on inside that van. Lots of screening, and they still do it. Screen around 8,000 people a year, is that true, Steve? Something like that? 14,000 a year now, okay. And based on the data from CRY, we don't just go around screening people. CRY's been pivotal in doing all this. And this is basically This is all the publications, and we've published loads and loads of things. But based on all of these ECG papers, we have come up with a method, which this paper will be published, that tells you how you should be screening athletes and how you should be interpreting their ECGs. And this is a brand new thing that's gone on at St. George's, which is going to be a landmark paper for athletes, white and black. And it's shown that if you screen this way, this is Nabil Sheikh's paper, who's also one of my fellows, you increase the specificity of picking up serious problems to 94%, and for picking up serious conditions to 93%. What about false negatives? It's all right saying, okay, what about me patting someone on the back and say, you're okay to exercise? Well, we will miss things. There is no doubt about it. We will miss anomalous coronary arteries. We'll miss atherosclerosis. We'll also miss commotio cordis, myocarditis, and electrolyte disturbances. What goes on the pitch? Sometimes it's not what you miss, it's what went on the pitch. Red Bull, excess Red Bull, Jack 3D, and all these performance enhancing agents that the athletes believe are good for them. If there are any athletes in this room, if any supplement has made you feel better, it's not good for you. Just remember that, okay? Because there's obviously something in it that you shouldn't be taking. So why don't we just use AEDs? Forget screening, get an AED on every football pitch, and you shock them out of it if they ever go down. I just want to show you this slide where you've got survivors of sudden death and non-survivors. And you'll find that if you had hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and you had a cardiac arrest during marathon running, you'd never survived. So it's all right saying, let's have a defibrillator, but resuscitation rates with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy are really bad because the athlete's dehydrated, they're acidotic, and we don't always get them back easily. So I think screening is still better than just having an AED, although they're adjunctive and they should be used together. And then finally, cost. I don't want you to assimilate all of these unless you're top accountants. But what this study shows, in a nutshell, is that if we screened athletes, we would be spending about £43,000 to give back 1 year of life. And you think, £43,000 to give back 1 year? That's extortionate. If I told you that we spend far more than that and on an octogenarian who will only live 2 years, okay? We spend far more than that. We spend far more than that on dialysis patients. These are all deserving causes, but we spend more than that to give them a year of life. Well, if we spend far more than that by putting an ICD into a patient who's got a serious condition, again, deserving, and we spend far more by providing AEDs all over the public. So you have to ask yourselves whether £43,000 really is a lot. Do AEDs make a difference? Well, they certainly do. Survival rates have gone up and up and up with AEDs to as high as 64% if you use them quickly. But you need to. But it's important to teach you guys to CPR, because if you CPR within a minute and a half of the patient going down, the outlook goes up dramatically. If a shock can be delivered within 3.5 minutes, the outlook goes up dramatically. But of course, you need good personnel who know what they're doing. You need a good communication system. People need to know where the AED is kept. And people should be practicing what will happen when D-Day comes during a sporting event. Everyone got this? I'm now going to show you one horror film and one positive ending. Here's the horror film that happened 10 years ago live on TV. This is the Federations Cup 2003. Cameroon playing and a player is down. Put your stop clocks on. Now they're on, okay? Put the stop clock on. He's getting attended to, this young man. You can see they're trying to maintain his airway at this point. Stop clock's on, okay. There's a commotion going on between the ref and the players as to whether the player's fit enough to carry on. And you'll now see in slow motion what actually happens. No contact, down, loss of tone, eyeballs at the back of the head. This doesn't look pretty at all. Keep your stopwatches on. The seconds are ticking away. There's still a commotion going. Has any form of resuscitation been commenced? The manager is more worried about who's going to be substituted next rather than the player. And I don't blame them. They couldn't believe that a young guy could possibly die on them. It can't happen. That's how they used to think. And that, if I can impress upon you that these things do happen and they can be prevented, then I think I'll have achieved some. Here you go. A slap on the cheek might get him out of his cardiac arrest. A bit of a cold sponge on the chest might help. No CPR at all. Have 3 minutes elapsed yet? Because if they have, he's dead. Okay, 11 minutes elapsed before anybody felt this man's pulse. But we learned something from this. We learned a lot. And this happened in France, not in Timbuktu. So I could carry on playing this. But this is what happened at my time. So you can see, none of you saw this going on your TVs. But look at that. The emergency crew are already there, already. You can see that the doctors are on the case. They've established that he's in cardiac arrest. So we're at 53 seconds. CPR has not been started yet. But the gloves are going on. And hurrah, stops. CPR started. Still not 100%, they should be carrying on, but there's so much noise there, and they themselves said they couldn't believe it was happening to them. So now the defib pad's going on. So 2 minutes lapsed. And I think they've established he's in VF now. He got two shocks on the pitch, and they carried on resuscitating. The only good news was that the TV cameras moved away so you guys couldn't see what was going on, which was very sensible of them. I'd like to conclude that sudden death in sport is rare. The diagnosis of cardiac pathology can be challenging. Screening does identify athletes with high risk, and AED should always be used as an adjunct. And I'd like to finish by introducing an athlete who you will all recognize very shortly, who was screened as part of this campaign, a national rugby player, who was diagnosed with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy on the basis of an abnormal ECG, and who announced his retirement. So a little tribute to Lee Mears before he comes on.
Take what comes your way. Oh, if you know what you want, feel how do you want to feel it? If you know what you want to say, oh, I wanna hear you say it. If you know where you want to go, how far do you want to take it? Cause no matter what mistakes you make, these are your redemption days.
Lee Mears, ladies and gentlemen.
Hi guys, thank you very much. Thank you for having me along. I'm glad Sanjay brought some technology, because a bit like working with animals, rugby players should never be allowed near any technology. So I'm afraid you've just got me without any fancy slides. As you can see there, a bit of a background for those of you that don't know. I was a Torbay lad, a young down in Devon, born and bred. And I basically moved up the echelons of rugby through England under 16s, under 18s. I eventually went on a scholarship to a school in Bristol and joined some of my very close friends over in Bath and did 16 years, wonderful years. Looking back at that made me smile, of playing professional rugby and along with also being able to go on two World Cups, 43 England caps, and probably one of the highlights of my career, a British Lions tour. And to give you a bit of background into my sort of how I was screened, 2003 in France, that sort of set a precedent. All of a sudden, a high-profile athlete dies, and it starts to get looked at. Oh my goodness, you know, these guys are really fit. Obviously, looking at me, you may chuckle and say, "I saw you on the video. You're not really fit." But no, we, you know, when someone like that sort of passes away and dies, it really sets a precedent. So we're all about to board a plane in 2007 to go to a World Cup in France, a Rugby World Cup. We've been training for 10 weeks, and you get hooked up to a machine. You are a little bit of a lab rat as a rugby player. You know, you get pushed around, told to lift this, eat that, do this, do that. And so you get hooked on a machine. And that was the first time I'd ever had an ECG or an echocardiogram. And I had a small, nothing major anomaly. There's about five of us got moved to one side, had an echo, off you go, you're fine, you can get on the plane. So that's how I assumed it all worked. Carried on doing what I was doing. Training did get a little bit harder as the years went on and it got more professional. Probably I was getting older, that's why it felt a bit tougher. But 2009, I had another ECG, 2010. I mean, we're very lucky. You've got to realise that we are, and that's why I love to stand up here in front of you guys and say how lucky we are with the type of testing, how cutting edge this kind of thing is. And that's why I, you know, say to any of you, if you can ever get what we call an MOT done or just get looked at, it could be huge for you. Because all of a sudden, 2012, I turn up to the rugby club and smile sweetly at the lady, and she's in the room now, and say, "Oh, you know, can I have my echo done?" So, you know, something comes up, and you can always tell in the face, "Yeah, oh, something's not right." And I thought, oh, I assumed it's like 2007. Stick me on the nice, and I'll give it in rugby terms, the nice one where you get a video, and I'll be fine. And the look on the face, no, it's something not right, you know, but you just need it looked into. And so, of course, as a rugby player, you're bulletproof. You think you're bulletproof. You know, I lift, you know, back then, you squat 225 kilos, you bench press 170 kilos, you can run all day. I'm fine, it's nothing. Have a couple more tests, they all came back fine, you know, we're pretty fit. But there's something about this ECG that you've got to have investigated. And we went through tests, and then I came up to see Sanjay himself. And, you know, we looked at it. During that time, I'd also had an MRI scan, and that's when it showed the thickening. So everything came from that one ECG. A lot of the tests I passed with flying colours, and it isn't until you get to see that picture, that sort of scan of the heart and the thickening, that, you know, you realise something's wrong. And then it's the dilemma. What do you do? You know, there's a risk. It's a risk no matter what. Do you carry on playing? Do you retire? Now, at the time, it's all I ever knew. You know, rugby's my life from sort of 14, 15, when you start to realise that you're not bad at getting bashed in the head, so you might take it up as a job, and you basically go on and on. And so I was there, you know, with Sanjay in the room discussing, you know, the pros and the cons. The pros at the moment are that, you know, I get to play rugby with my mates, you know, win games, have this amazing elation. The cons are that, but this time I have two lovely boys and a wife, and no matter how big a risk it is, there's more to life. You know, hopefully there's other things that you can succeed in. But just watching that video brings it back to me that how you saw the boys, did you see his teammates? You know, because we say we're like a family, and you are unbelievably close. You go through a lot, as professional athletes, a bit like the Olympics. You can tell when there's an amazing affiliation, when you've all got a common goal, when you really buy into it. And that just showed me on the video how passionate the other boys are around their friend who's there having a heart attack. And then you realise, well, if that's your mates, what would your family be like if they ever saw you in that situation? And then that was the sort of the sort of ringing of the bell, the realisation that there is more out there. And once it was also explained that I can do some exercise, so that I wouldn't go mental, and the fact that if I didn't do any exercise, my wife would probably kill me. So that was another tick in the box. You can still do certain things and go on and live a normal life. And so it was quite lucky for me. You know, I was 34 at the time. Some would consider that as being a bit old in the rugby stages, and it's probably a safe thing to do. Had I been 26, geez, it would have been even a more of a dilemma. But when you've got a family to look after and so many close friends, and you see pictures like that, it's amazing. So I can't do enough for cry. I can't say thank you enough, because if it wasn't for that sort of ECG and picking up those kind of things, you never know. It's not even worth thinking about what could have happened. But yes, so now I just wrestle and do Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, which helps me still beat people up and get beaten up, which seems to tick a few boxes and make me feel better. That's pretty much my story, and I'm going to introduce someone from CRY now to tell you what a wonderful job that they do.
How many fit and healthy young people under the age of 35 do you think die every week in the UK? Just a show of hands, if you think it's A, less than one, B, between 2 and 5, C, 6 and 9, and D, more than 10. A, B, between 2 and 5, C, 6 and 9, and D, more than 10. Okay, well, the statistic which we use is 12 fit and healthy young people every week. When we started in 1995, when we were launched as a charity, we believed it was only one a week. This was based on anecdotal evidence, working with Professor Sharma and Professor McKenna at St. George's Hospital, which is where CRY started many years ago. In fact, we started screening in 1993 with the Lawn Tennis Association. Very quickly, we realized that was an underestimation. And in 2008, we published a paper showing it was at least 12 fit and healthy young people every week. So what do we try and do as an organisation? We aim to raise awareness of young sudden cardiac death. We provide support and counselling to people after they've been either diagnosed with a condition or after a young sudden death. We do cardiac screening, we've heard a lot about that today, and also we support research. We have fantastic patrons like Ian Botham, Steve Redgrave, John Inverdell, all of whom have been affected by young sudden deaths. John Inverdell has been affected in a number of ways, with close friends, then the child of Howard English, who died with John Inverdell, died 10 years later of the same condition that killed the father. And that launched the CRY Centre for Cardiac Pathology with Mary Shepherd, who has recently, as Sanjay said, moved to St. George's, which we're very proud of. As Sanjay's talked about, there was a tipping point in 2012. After his collapse, we had as much contact within the following month as we would usually have had within a year. And it's the work of CRY and everyone who's been trying to raise awareness of young sudden death that what happened to Foey didn't happen to Fabrice Muamba, because people were aware of these conditions and that fit and healthy young people do die suddenly. People reacted quickly and led to his miraculous recovery. But shortly after, Claire Squires died at the London Marathon. And although we see the sudden deaths in elite athletes, the vast majority of sudden deaths, although they're at less risk if you're not a high-level athlete, are actually in the general population of people who enjoy sport recreationally or at a grassroots level. Since CRY started, there have been over 10,000 young sudden deaths in the UK. And as Sanjay said, they use many, many years of life, tens of thousands of years lost every year. And the impact, as with any sudden death of a young person, is not just on the immediate family, it goes much wider. It's the siblings, the parents, the grandparents, sometimes children, which would be more than 3,000 people every year who have lost someone in their immediate family. But then there's the wider family, the nieces, the nephews, the uncles, aunts, then the intimate and wider social networks of friends, partners, schoolmates, workmates, teammates, and then, as we saw with the impact with Fabrice Muamba, the wider community. And if you see some of the blogs of the athletes, elite athletes who have died, people say how they will never forget that moment that they saw that person collapse and die. So as an organisation, one of the most important things we do is raise awareness. We raise awareness of family history. These are inherited conditions, as we've discussed. And when there has been a young sudden death, it's very important to contact CRI, because we will help refer the family so they don't just go and have an ECG with their GP and be told they're all right. They'll be referred to St. George's or one of the other specialist units where they will have all tests done on the same day with the family unit, not just an ECG ultrasound, an additional test, and they will leave that clinic with a diagnosis, usually. We raise awareness of the symptoms to look out for. As we've said, chest pain, exercise-related, passing out, syncope, when it's a cardiac faint, red flags, and then more arbitrary symptoms, like breathlessness, palpitations. But as Sanjay said, 80% of young sudden deaths are asymptomatic, and that's where our screening program comes in. Where the research has been done, we've seen a massive reduction in sudden deaths. So just to check whether you're listening to what Sanjay said, how many people within our screening program would you say are identified with potentially life-threatening conditions? A, more than 1 in 100, B, 1 in 100 to 500, 500 to 1,000, or 1 in 1,000, more than, less than 1 in 1,000. Would that be A? B, 1 in 500 to 1 in 500? Couple of people were listening. So 1 in 500 to 1 in 1,000. No more hands now. So they're not, less than 1,000. So it's, the answer is 1 in 300. And 1 in 100 will have a less serious cardiac condition, but something which could have a very serious impact in your fourth decade of life. And at that point, you may be presenting to a cardiac clinic with a problem which has gone too far and is much more difficult to deal with. And if there were 1,000 people in the room, I would probably be very very intimidated right now, but there would be three people in the audience who, if they'd been tested at the age of 14, would have had conditions like Wolff Parkinson White, a cardiomyopathy, or an ion channel condition like long QT. And the WPW would probably be ablated if you were at risk. The cardiomyopathy, you may have to stop playing competitive sports. The long QT, you may have to stop taking certain drugs and other lifestyle modifications. And then there'd probably be 10 people who would hopefully be prevented from presenting in that ward in their 40s. We're incredibly proud of our partnership with St. George's and everything we've achieved since we've started. And we've been working with Professor Sharma for many years, as with Professor Mary Shepherd and other cardiologists. And we've funded, I'm not sure how many fellows now, I think we're going into 15 fellows have now come through and been trained to become specialists in inherited cardiovascular disease, and they've left us and they're working throughout the country. Some of those are now their consultants as well. And this is something, as I say, we're incredibly proud. We're a relatively small organization compared to the likes of the British Heart Foundation. And although many people think of these sudden deaths rightfully as rare compared to some of the big issues which are faced in society, it is. Young sudden cardiac death is one of the most common causes of sudden death in young people, behind suicide and road traffic accidents. So it is actually, from the young person's perspective, there's a very serious risk there. And we encourage our children to wear seatbelts when they drive a car, because we're worried about that, but we don't consider screening. We test thousands, 14,000 people last year, and we've got a unique program. And I think just important, because raising awareness is so important, and to know about the opportunity to be tested. We do, we've got a fantastic clinic here at St. George's where we're here every month, which is an open clinic. It's fully funded. You just walk in, book an appointment, you can be tested if you're between the age of 14 and 35. And I think if there's anything you can do to help us raise awareness, that's fantastic. Obviously, getting involved and participating in fundraising events is amazing, and that's, some people choose to do that through volunteering at our events. Having people cheer on people at the London Marathon is one of the things we're repeatedly told how important that is. It's an amazing thing for people doing that for us and then to be cheered on. And some people choose to get involved in using their skills. We've got an amazing team of almost 100 physiologists throughout the country who are involved in our screening program and do an immense amount to help us raise awareness outside of that program. But also, just social media is an amazing way for us to efficiently raise awareness with a wide population. So if you can like us on Facebook and retweet some of our tweets and maybe the research which we publish, which we put out on our feed as soon as it comes up, would be absolutely fantastic. So the more you can help us to raise awareness, the more lives will be saved. And just thank you very much for taking a few minutes to listen to me. Thank you.